Mason, who's going to give us an update on the new offensive coordinator for the University of Maryland. Mr. Canada, tell us about our new coordinator.
A guy that Wayne can vouch for me. I've liked the offense they ran at LSU, which is what his most recent stop was. Before that, he made stops at NC State and Wisconsin.
So he's not your typical college run-and-gun quarterback, is he? He's more pro type.
Yeah, more of a pro type. It's the offense that I've been calling for, more of a power spread look. He uses the spread concept, but it's more in a power run. They're definitely going to be able to get those one-yard plays this year.
And let me issue a question right now. There was a lot of talk about the guy from UCLA, Fish, but did he make a decision yet as to where he's going?
No, I do not believe so.
Jed Fish. So this was kind of guy that Durkin wanted, correct?
Yes, it was. And I'm going to throw out some stats for you, Bruce.
Go ahead.
At his one season in Wisconsin was the year that Monty Ball ran the ball for 1,830 yards and 22 touchdowns and won the Doak Walker. At Pitt, they scored the most points per game out of any Power 5 team, and they were the only team to beat Clemson the year they won the national championship.
Wow, that's
LSU, with Purdue's reject quarterback, they were still in the top 100 in passing yards and total offense.
What happened at LSU? Why was he dismissed? Did he leave, or is this the upgrade, or what happened?
There were some talks of differences between him and Ed Ogeron. Look, it really just wasn't working. They had games like the one against Troy where they just could not get a yard. But a lot of that was chalked up to the quarterback that he had, Danny Etling, the guy that left Purdue, was accepted by the LSU program, ends up being now a two-year starter there, just not at the level that you need in the SEC, and it was kind of blamed on Matt Canada.
And, of course, he elevated who, Chris Beatty, to co-offensive coordinator. What's your take on that? That associate head coach, wide receivers coach, Chris Beatty, has been elevated to co-offensive coordinator. What's Canada's role going to be? The offensive coordinator, the play caller, or how's that going to work?
I think he's going to be the player. Chris Beatty is a great recruiter. Matt Canada is a great coach. Been in the running for a lot of coordinator of the year stuff. I would like him to see him be the play caller. That's what I think his main job is going to be. Let the other guys do the recruiting. He'll put the guys in the right places to make the plays, and they will.
Have you noticed the growth of DJ Moore in the draft? He seems to be climbing almost every day. I can't wait till he gets to the combine. I think that the play of Diggs in a weird way helps him out, and his sure hands helps him out the most. Where do you see DJ Moore going in the NFL draft?
As the stock climbs, Dennis and I talked about it last week on the show, it might be a late first rounder, depending on how he performs in the combine. I definitely don't see him falling past the third round. It's kind of up in the air right now. Some sites have him ranked as high as the first wide receiver, some around the 20 mark. So right now, before the combine, before his pro day, I'm really uncertain about it, but I really can't see him falling past the third round.
Do you like this kid Ridley from Alabama?
Not as much as I liked guys like Julio Jones.
He's not on that level.
I think he's a little bit smaller than them, but he still made big plays when it mattered. You know, a team's going to take him really high in the draft.
I think his brother might be the one. All right, his baby brother could be the guy. I mean, I don't know that for a fact, but he had an unbelievable game for the opposites. And Yannick Ngakoue was just added to the Pro Bowl squad. You know, how's a guy go to the pros and he really shines more than he did at Maryland? Now, he had a good career at Maryland, don't get me wrong. But this is the pro level, and he's such a force out there. He beefed up. He's a defensive end now, strictly. And a great, great, great signs for Maryland that we have pros doing so well, and yet Maryland didn't do so well. A little strange, isn't it?
Yes, it is, and I'm really happy for Yannick Ngakoue. He was really felt that he was disrespected by the voters when he was not selected originally to the Pro Bowl. Now he got that go. it's just really great to see these Terps performing the way they are in the pros.
Yeah, they certainly are. And Michigan State, we have any hope on Sunday? Let me issue that. Doesn't seem like it, but strange things happen when you're at home, especially in College Park.
That's where I was going, Bruce. I really see a real chance to make something happen on Sunday. Great game. You know, getting that opportunity is always something special at Xfinity Center. For some reason, in my heart, I just think Maryland's going to pull this one out.
That's because it's in your heart, all right? And it's a tough call for Maryland. It's a tough game for Maryland. I think a lot of it depends if Bruno does play. You know, I'm, of course, Sikofsky's another guy. He plays better at home for the most part. He just plays better at home. And the way he played the other night, it was just, of course, he was, you know, trying to guard Jawan Morgan. The guy was much faster than him. It almost looked at one time that Jawan Morgan got a charging call. I'm not sure it was. I think he was just so much stronger than Sikofsky. He just kind of physically pushed him out of the way.
Bruce, I think at this point in the season, we've decided that every guy on the roster plays better at home, as expected. It was a really tough matchup two times in a row playing against 6'7 to 6'9 centers, and they really just dominated the game. Now, Michigan State really doesn't have that guy. Unless they go really small, it's going to be a better matchup for Tchaikovsky, Fernando, Tomajic, whoever they put out there.
Yeah, well, that guy Ward was phenomenal. But if you look at the stats of their subs and their second-tier players since that game, they have not been there. All of a sudden, they don't show up. They didn't show up against Ohio State. I mean, it was almost unreal. Then they lose at home to Michigan. Michigan got schooled by Nebraska. So, again, you're talking about the home court advantage means everything in the Big Ten, and that's my hope. And I was listening to the guys on the BTN talking about how Michigan's schedule's so tough, and the last game of the year could be crucial for them, and they have to play it at Maryland. And they were talking about how what a great environment it is in Maryland. But with that, we're past our first break. Mason, thanks a lot for coming in. And this is Bruce Posner. You're listening to Coons Ford presents Terp Talk here on CBS Sports Radio 1300.